and speed of light in a particular medium.
Jared Cornish.
Stop. Yeah. You know, Jared, you know, normally when something's moving, it cannot spontaneously emit particles. Energy and momentum conservation for movement. Okay? However, there are special, if you've got an object that's moving faster than the speed of light, then kinematics change. And it's possible to spontaneously emit stuff in a process very similar to Jared. So what these guys more or less demonstrate is, at least within the standard model, these neutrinos that are moving, that if they were moving faster than the speed of light, would have emit Cherenkov radiation. Okay, so this Cherenkov radiation would be through weak interactions in this case, and would actually be a Cherenkov radiation of E plus E minus bits. But the important thing is not, it's just an analogy. The word is used as an analogy. The important thing is that something moving faster than the speed of light could and would slow down spontaneously by emission of particles. And then they calculated how long what fraction of the flux would survive from CERN to Grand Sasso, so, and found it was a negligible fraction. Okay? So, their point is that it's just that, you know, unless you give up much more than the speed of light, it's just not a self-consistent explanation of what's going on there. That this thing moves faster than the speed of light. I don't know. This sounds right to me. It sounds like this experiment must be wrong. So let's continue. More serious stuff. Please. This paper was on Friday, so if you look up the MPH archive, by Glashow and Cohen, I don't remember the name. It's a very good paper, it's 2-3 pages. It actually turns this estimate of Cherenkov radiation around to analyze other experiments that have not seen things going faster than the speed of light, but have also not seen attenuation. You know, you've sent a neutrino out from here, it's reached there. Because of that, because if it was moving faster than the speed of light, there would be Cherenkov radiation, only a fraction would reach there. So it uses other experimental data to put an upper bound on how much the deviation of neutrino speed from speed of light could possibly be. And they get an answer like 10 to the minus 10, just purely experimental. I mean, so if you accept a little theory in between, basically, they say, but this experiment is not consistent.
That can be checked, right?
What?
The number of neutrinos, the fraction of neutrinos that reach.
Yeah,
so you're using the Cherenkov radiation, and you can check it with what the data is.
Exactly, so in this Grand Sasso experiment, the number that reaches is consistent without any change.
It's without.
Yes.
It's just the spreading of the beam.
Exactly. So, this is not a thing that's occurred to the experimentalist at all, I think. Okay. So, you know, from that point of view, the neutrinos were emitted here, they reached there. Okay. The point of this new paper is that had they been moving faster than the speed of light, they couldn't all have reached. So it's not self-consistent. This explanation is not self-consistent. Unless you start giving up other pieces of physics as well. Maybe
you'd rather give up the speed of light.
No, but you see, we're not given the option here of giving up the speed of light. Take the option of giving up the speed of light. Can you find a consistent explanation without giving up other parts of physics? No. I think we've been cornered into finding that the experiment is wrong. All that, you know, we've just the last 200-300 years of physics have been misplaced. Okay. Excellent. So let's continue. Just to remind you, in the last class we were discussing the Landau Lipschitz stress energy tensor, the stress energy pseudo tensor, and we had a series of expressions, which I won't all write down all over again. I mean, maybe. Yeah. we first have this object, the four index object, lambda I, k, L, m, so let's call it alpha m, because my i's and my l's are too similar, which is equal to 1 by 16 by k into minus g into g I k g alpha m minus g I alpha g. Okay. In terms of which we define this three index object, which we call h I k alpha, which was equal to del by del xm of lambda I k alpha m. And in terms of this three index object h, we have the conserved quantity. Okay. The conserved quantity was del by del xl. And now x alpha of h I k alpha. Okay. This was the conserved quantity. This actually we had called minus g or plus g. Minus g, that's the ik total. Okay, and this conserved quantity, this quantity of the equation, so this quantity here, of the equation, del by del x alpha h I k alpha, was a symmetric in I and k, and b conserved. That is the derivative of the equation del by del xk of del by del x alpha h I k alpha. Okay? And these two properties follow just directly. These are just identities involving algebra and hyperphysics. Okay? But the interesting claim was that this T total is equal to T max in a frame in which when G alpha beta beta, and which first derivatives of the length matched. Okay, now I am planning to derive this for you last class, where we didn't get the time, and it's going to take like 15 or 20 minutes if I try to do it here. Basically, I judge it's not worth it. So I'm going to put this in your next problem. So we have now the next problem set by Monday. People, we want the first problem set. Okay. Okay, so let's make, you know, let's really try to have it. Today was the deadline I lasted yesterday to you. I don't see any problems. That's here. Let's really try to have it by next Monday. Okay? By the middle of this week we'll send you new problems. And one of the problems will be showing this thing algebra. Just algebra. But it should be done either in class or the problem and probably better. Okay. Yes.
Third question about this.
Yes.
So right now del alpha of that quantity is zero.
Del alpha.
Del x.
Del x. Yes.
Is equal to zero. This conservation law holds in a flat space time.
No, you see, this is just algebra.
Okay, fine. I'm sorry. But I mean, the interpretation you were discussing when you have curved space time domain and the integral of it is zero. That holds in a flat space-time.
No, you see, this is an algebraic identity.
No, this is okay.
Yes.
The thing you're trying to explain further than this, namely the fact that when you have asymptotically flat spacetime, then when you integrate HI and GAN, you get a conserved charge.
Yes.
So that conservation law holds in the asymptotically flat spacetime.
Yes,
so
yes.
Basically what you're doing is you're describing the dynamics of some third spacetime.
Yes.
Using some quantity in a flat spacetime.
Yeah. You see, what we're doing is this. We're looking at dynamics that's going on in spacetime. The dynamics could be complicated. The spacetime could be complicated relatively. But we're assuming that all the complication is localized. So that far away, your spacetime becomes flat. Okay? And defining an energy momentum, energy and momentum for the system, with reference to that flat space.
With reference to a flat
time. A flat space time at infinity.
So can we do this, pretty commonly? You have dynamics of a metric, and then you see it as a fixed metric and some dynamics on that.
Fixed metric at infinity.
At infinity. Dynamics on that fixed metric.
Dynamics inside about that fixed metric. It's the kind of thing we do quite routinely in everything we do. You see, for instance, suppose you were doing electromagnetism and you had electrons roaming around but never going off to infinity. Okay, they can go very far but never, let's say, beyond this limit. Okay? Then the electromagnetic field at infinity would die off at most 1 by r of this radiation. So at infinity, the electromagnetic field goes to zero. Okay? So it's a very similar thing happening here.
But, in this, you have the dynamics of the metric itself.
The dynamics of the metric.
And you're saying dynamics of a metric can be seen as in a way that you have a fixed metric at some field.
A fixed metric at infinity.
At infinity and some field on. Mathematically speaking, it's just fixed metric, right?
At infinity. Not in the middle. We're not referring, we're not requiring any particular fixed space time in the middle. What we're doing is putting boundary conditions. You know, we're solving Einstein's equation subject to certain boundary conditions. The boundary conditions are that the metric becomes flat at infinity. Okay? It's a reasonable boundary condition in a situation in which you don't have any sources for the curvature at infinity. Just like if you solve Maxwell's equations, with the boundary condition, the gauge field goes to zero at infinity. That's a reasonable boundary condition provided you don't have sources of charge. But it's important that we're not asking for the space to be flat at infinity. Just at infinity. Okay, this is a reasonable thing to do. It's what we always do when we do, you know, field theory. You see, because when we want to solve some equations of motion, so let's talk. When we want to solve some equations of motion, we need to be able to evaluate spatial derivatives. So suppose you were on a computer, you wanted to solve some equation of motion. You discretize space, so you put points in place. You do this, but you know, because you're on a computer, you have to end space. So that's some endpoint for your space. Okay. Now, how do you evaluate the derivatives here? You can't unless you have a boundary condition. Okay, so to make the problem of the initial value problem well defined, you need a boundary condition at the edge of your space. Now, we sometimes hide this boundary condition by taking space to be infinitely big. But of course, the boundary condition is still there. There's some implicit boundary condition that things aren't blowing up at. So this is something we routinely do when we look at a field theory in any system covered by differential equations. At the edge of our space, we need boundary conditions. Okay? When we take the space to be arbitrarily big, there are sometimes very physically very natural boundary conditions. And these are the boundary conditions. That's all we're doing. We're not doing more than that. Is this scale? Okay? These boundary conditions are what's called the requirement that space-time be asymptotically flat.
That allows waves to propagate.
Because waves die out like 1 by r. anywhere that is sourced by something localist. The only way we could not die out is if it was sourced by something infinitely bigger. That would violate your boundary conditions. Yeah.
So if you have a manifold that's curved upon itself,
yes,
periodic boundary.
Yes.
So then how do you go about?
Yes. So the question of trying to define energy on a closed manifold, for instance, I don't know how to do it. I don't know how to do it. I don't think anyone has a satisfactory definition. So this definition is really limited to asymptotically flat spaces. Spacetimes are an infinity good flat space. It can be extended to many other situations. For instance, spacetimes that at the infinity become anti-de Sitter space. If you have another situation of interest, you can try to extend it. Okay. But note that from the fact that finite energy configurations do not, you might think I can try to disturb what goes on in infinity by pumping a lot of energy into the system. But we've seen how things behave. The energy of the system is measured by the fall off of this H field as we go to infinity, and the fall off is slow. I mean, it's 1 by r length. Okay? So if you start with the spacetime that's asymptotic, you would, to get out of that situation, you would need an infinite amount of energy. Okay, for this reason, this is a self-consistent thing to do. It's not the most general thing to do, but it's sufficient for a certain class of questions. Okay, now if you don't have a boundary, it's very possible that there is no interesting notion of energy in some absolute sense. And the reason for that is that, you see, what is energy? Energy is the conserved quantity due to time translation. Now, therefore, for an energy, you need some time. In general relativity, there's no distinguished coordinate. So there's no particularly interesting time. But maybe your boundary conditions can do it. Now, so if you put the boundary conditions that the space is asymptotically flat, you've got something distinguished happening at the boundary. There's a nice time coordinate at the boundary. And that can be used as a crutch on which to define energy. Okay? But if you don't have anything like this, if your space time is closed, there's no particularly natural notion of energy. Certainly it's not
different. But you could have discrete time translation on a closed manifold.
But you know, if you've got a closed space-time, it could be that there are other conserved quantities, but it's far from clear that you want to call that energy. Okay, but let's go on. Umesh, please don't disturb this. Okay. The last thing that that we were talking about last class, the one thing that I wanted to say that I didn't get the time to say, or maybe I said but not as clearly as I should have, is the following. We went through these arguments that the stress energy tensor, that the energy and momentum measured by the stress tensor is the same for every choice of internal core. We also went through the arguments that every choice of internal coordinates that leaves a flat space coordinate fixed, and that these things transform like Lorentz vectors under change of coordinates that transform the flat space coordinates in a boost manner. The last thing I wanted to say that I didn't at least emphasize enough is that the expression for energy momentum is really simple in the sense of as follows. Look, suppose I wanted to compute Pi. Okay? So what am I going to do? I'm going to take this expression and this conserved expression and dot it with respect to the normal to my space-like vector, the space-like surface. and integrate it. Okay, so what I'm supposed to do is to take H I alpha. Oh, no, we use beta, then there's alpha, so that's del by del x alpha, and do this integral, where this object here is the normal to my, to the volume element on my spatial surface, just to be completely concrete. What is this object? This object is epsilon beta phi 1 phi 2 phi 3 dx phi 1 dx phi 2 dx phi 3 1 by 3 factorial. Okay, well, these are the three infinitesimal displacements that make up three independent infinitesimal displacements on the three surfaces. Okay? This epsilon is just the object whose components are 1 and 0. There's no metric in this thing. Okay? This is the quantity that will guarantee to be conserved. However, you see that this quantity itself is a derivative. So you can write a more convenient expression for the quantity. Instead of writing it as an integral over all space, we can once again use Gauss's theorem. Okay? To rewrite this as equal to H I beta alpha, and then epsilon beta alpha phi 2 factorial, now dx phi 2 phi 3 for psi phi dx psi dx phi, where this is now an area element on the boundary of the space-like manifold that we chose. Okay? So we've got the space-like manifold that we, so let's draw this again. So we've got all the space-time now. We've got the space-like manifold that runs through it. And this integral is taken on the space-like manifold. Okay? But the space-like manifold has boundary near infinity. It's a two-dimensional boundary. And this integral is taken on the two-dimensional boundary. Okay? What this makes clear is that the notion of energy and momentum in general relativity is very similar the notion of charge in electrodynamics. See, in electrodynamics, if you wanted to measure the charge in your space-time, you could do two things. Either you could do an integral over space and totaling up every bit of charge that there is in space. Or you could do something more simple. You could just take a huge surface surrounding your space and measure the flux of E through that surface. From Gauss's law, these two things mean the same thing. The second thing is a more simple thing to do, because you don't have to do a volume integral, you just have to sit at infinity. Sitting at infinity, you know how much charge is. Because charge leaves its mark in electric field. Okay? So, really, that's the way you should think of the notion of energy and energy and momentum. Okay? Whatever's happening in the center, some complicated dynamics, leaves its mark at infinity. Okay? And this is the mark at infinity that measures the energy and momentum of the space-time. Okay? So energy and momentum in general relativity can be measured sitting entirely at infinity. Okay? And it's measured by the deviation of the metric from flatness. The first deviation of the metric from flatness. That's what this H will measure. Because you see, had G just been eta, all the derivatives that go into defining H would be zero. So it's the first deviation from eta that matters. Okay? And roughly speaking, how are we going to get something finite? How are we going to get something finite? Well, we're doing an integral over a big two sphere. The area element of the two sphere scales like R squared. Okay? Now, H, the components of the first deviation of away from flat space, will die out at infinity like 1 over R, as you see from Schwarzschild metric. Okay? But this quantity is not just the deviation of the metric, it's a derivative of the deviation. So that will die out like 1 over R squared. So the 1 over R squared in this will cancel the R squared in the volume element, giving something finite. Okay? So this formula tells you that space times in which you've got 1 over R falloffs are away from flat space metric, are finite energy. These are the space times that we will call asymptotically flat. They're finite energy excitations around flat. Spacetimes with lower than that falloff, with 1 over R squared falloff, are sort of zero energy. And are suspicious. If you get such a spacetime, you should start searching to see if you can find the coordinate transformation that will make it exactly that. Okay? Because at least with reasonable matter content, there's almost nothing you can do, no way in which you can pack matter in and not have energy. Okay. Of course, if your matter content is funny, if you have negative energy densities, it's so. But at least with reasonable matter content. Okay. And space times which fall off slower than 1 over R, suppose you have 1 over square root R fall off, you're not dealing with an asymptotically flat space. Okay, the space time at infinity is not flat. It's not a finite energy excitation of a flat space. Maybe an interesting solution of general energy, but it's not asymptotically flat. Okay? I think this is all I wanted to say about the energy momentum pseudotensor. So there are two things that we have not derived in class. First thing is this, the algebra that tells us that gives us this. We talked about how to do it, and we'll give you a problem set. The second thing that we have not derived in class is the actual expression for the pseudotensor. Meaning, when we wrote this as T total, and then T total minus T matter gives you the gravitational part. What is the gravitational part? So we've not done that. That's listed in lambda. It's just that I'm not even going to ask you to derive it. Okay, but it's listed in lambda. It's just you can use it if you need to. There's nothing in principle, right? I mean, it's clear what to do. Yes. Okay.
So many space times can have the same H, right?
It's the same H at infinity.
Same integral. Yeah.
Oh yeah, sure.
Can we write the dynamics of the whole space-time at levels of H?
No, this is a conserved quantity.
But there's no way that you can have these other quantities which describe the dynamics of the field on those improperly flat space.
When you say... Okay, good question. But firstly, if you ask, can you write it just in terms of energy and moment?
Certainly.
Okay, so energy and momentum is conserved. What's happening in space is totally unreflected there. It just gives you a number that stays steady as dynamics progresses. Okay, now the next question you're asking is, can you reconstruct what's going on in space-time from knowing the various fall-offs of the field? This is very analogous to the question of an electromagnetism. Suppose I gave you an electromagnetism the expansion of the field at infinity in a power series in 1 by I. Okay? From that, each term there encodes additional data about what things are doing in the middle. The first term encodes the charge, the next term dipole, the next term. Okay? One could set up something similar there. But you would need a whole series.
So to reformulate, can we write down dynamics of GR and psi on asymptotically flat space-time as when you're dealing with quantities that are vectors in the asymptotically flat space-time?
No, let's say that here.
Yeah, asymptotically flat space-time.
Yeah.
You want to write the dynamics of the curved GR quantities inside. Now you're writing down different dynamics in the asymptotically flat space-time, which is covariant with respect to that flat space-time. Can you do that?
I still didn't understand the last part. Wait, so I got that you're interested in asymptotically flat space time. You're interested in that. And what is the second thing that you're trying to do?
I'm trying to figure out quantities like H,
mm-hmm.
in terms of which I'll write my dynamics in asymptotically flat space time,
mm-hmm.
which will reflect exactly my goals.
But you want to write it everywhere or just at infinity?
Okay.
H is defined everywhere.
H is defined everywhere.
H is. And so, do you know H everywhere? It's like doing the metric everywhere. I thought you were asking another question. Maybe this is what you were asking. I thought you were asking how can you look at what's happening at infinity and reconstruct what's happening in the middle? There are many things to say about that question. That's very interesting. Okay, it has recently, because of the ADS-EFT correspondence, been intensively studied in asymptotic ADS cases. Okay, and I would be very happy to tell you more about that. What is the follow-up? Okay, so let me write down the coordinate system. Okay. So suppose we have an ADS space that was that took the form dr squared by r squared. R squared z mu squared. When mu is equal to 1 to d. So this is a d plus 1 dimension. ADS. ADS d plus 1. Okay? Then the metric field at infinity has to fall off like in these coordinates. The metric field has to go like, let's see. Suppose I write G is equal to GADS plus H. Then H has to fall off like 1 over R to the power D minus. So d with these 4 should be 1 over r. That's 1 over r. That's just 1 over r. These are the normalizable fluctuations, the normalizable modes from our system. Okay? It's like the numbers are a bit different, but it's similar. Okay. You know, just like in flat space and ADS space, you can write down the energy and momentum of what's going on at the boundaries. In ADS space, you can do better. You can write down locally conserved boundary stresslets. Flat space also has this thing called the Brown-Yorke stress tensor, which we may talk about. Okay, you can do better than just this conserved charge. It's very similar. Okay, this formula, by the way, is sometimes called the ADM. It's a bit incausal since Landau Lipschitz were well before ADM. But anyway, so ADM stands for Arnold, Deiser, Wiesner, something. Okay, and they have a more geometric and sort of more geometric way of thinking of this formula. But you see, we didn't need to get into all of that. We just followed our nose and had a nice way of answering. Okay. Other questions or comments? Otherwise, we need to move on. I want to talk about gravitational radiation. Okay, so Umesh, one more exercise for the problem set. I want people to evaluate the energy of the Schwarzschild's Western using this formula and check that its energy is the mass. Okay? Fine. Okay, so let's just, before we start in our discussion of black holes and cosmology, there are just two things, that two additional things that I want to discuss. Both very important. And the first one we're going to start discussing now, and that's the problem of gravitational radiation. Right. So, one of the big differences between Einstein's theory of relativity and the Newtonian theory is that there are degrees of freedom in the gravitational field. And these degrees of freedom can themselves be excited in the absence of matter, carry energy, momentum, you know, move around, just like they would be there. And to radiate. This rate, gravitational radiation. So just like in the Maxwell theory, a charge moving around things, it's accelerating in any way, emits electromagnetic radiation. In the Einsteinian theory, a mass moving around, accelerating in any way, actually, triple accelerator, as we will see, it's the third derivative of this, of this object that becomes important. Okay? Emits gravitational radiation. Okay? Now, this was always a cute fact about general relativity, but has, over the last 15 years or so, become very experimentally important. 20 years. So, become experimentally important. There was even a Nobel Prize given for the measurement of the following. You have, let's say, some very heavy star, and let's say a pulsar that's moving around it, and then slowly spiraling towards the star, losing energy because of gravitational radiation. You can calculate what the expected rate of the radiation we measure, and it matches the angle. Right, so this is one of the indirect checks of gravitational radiation in Einstein's theory. Okay, so this is the kind of thing that we want to understand. Okay, so the first thing we're going to start slow. The first thing we're going to do is to try to understand Einstein's equations in the absence of matter at the linearized level. Okay, so. You know, got a new theory, that's clearly one thing you do. If you take it at linearized, just to see what the linearized solutions are. Right. So, now, in beginning our exploration of this linearized theory, so in this linearized theory, we should see gravitational waves. Okay? But beginning our exploration of this linearized theory, we start by setting a gauge. That is, we start by making a coordinate choice. Okay, so even before that, so what are we doing? We're saying the metric B is G mu nu is equal to eta mu nu, parallel space, plus H B. Okay, and we're going to work in this lecture to first order H B. Now, this statement does not fix a choice of coordinates. Because as you have shown in your last problem set, or will have by next Monday, the change in the metric due to a coordinate change to first order in that coordinate change is given by where used for H. Okay? So we make a coordinate change that is of this form. X mu is equal to X prime plus, yeah, with the same smallness parameter as H. This is of order H. Okay? And now we ask, how does it change H? Yeah. So clearly, anything in this covariant derivative that uses the fact that it's covariant of the ordinary derivative knows about H. But it acts on eta, which is already about H. So that's order of smallness squared, we know. Okay? So the change is that delta H mu nu is just d mu than mu minus the plus d mu than mu over 5. Okay? So this H field here transforms under coordinate transformations according to this formula. Now, whenever you're dealing with gauge theory, the theory with some redundancy, it's often convenient to make, it often greatly simplifies life if you make the correct choice of gauge. Okay? And for the problem at hand, namely the study of gravitational radiation, there is a very convenient choice of gauge. Why it's convenient will become clear shortly, but first I'll tell you about it. The choice of gauge goes as follows. We follow Landau's transportation. Define this quantity. Psi mu nu is equal to H mu nu minus H by 2 eta mu delta mu nu. A word about raising and lowering indices. Indices in H are raised and lowered using the method theta. Okay? H is a small fluctuation over a flat space. Its indices are raised and lowered using the metric theta. So you should think of H as like a tensor field in flat space.
Is there some conditions for initial value?
What?
Are all initial conditions in flat space?
We're going to find. We're going to study the equations. Yes. H is of course constrained by the constraint equations. So one of the things we're going to do is to count how many fields we need to set. Okay. So now consider this object, and we can impose the gauge condition del mu psi mu. Lorentz gauge condition for electromagnetism. Except we're imposing the Lorentz gauge condition not on H mu nu itself, which you might have thought of as the most natural thing to impose it on, but it's more convenient to impose it on this one. Well, H, by the way, what is H? I should define. H is equal to H alpha eta eta alpha. Choose coordinates. We're going to choose our freedom. Okay. There were four functions in our hands. To set four conditions. The four conditions are labeled by this name. Okay. And now, One question immediately, does this condition completely fix what it wants? Okay, answer no. Let's find out. Suppose we've got a coordinate, we make a coordinate change. So suppose we've got an H that gives rise to a psi that satisfies this equation. We make a coordinate change and ask, can we find some sort of non-trivial coordinate changes that continue to satisfy this equation. Okay? So that's easy. All we have to do is to determine what the change in psi is because of this coordinate change, and then impose this condition on. Okay. So what firstly got is the change in H. The change in H was given here. Okay? So the change in delta psi is equal to delta psi is equal to minus of, let's put the indices as well, mu del mu nu plus del nu mu, and then plus how has little h changed? Little h has just changed by del dot, by minus of del dot h. Skip, because I take this formula and put it. Okay, so plus del dot theta into delta mu, and the half has gone away because of the twos. And little h changed by 2 delta, h by 2 delta.
Okay,
so
in
that
sense, I would say to you, but then mu eta delta over mu.
I'm sorry. Okay, now let's take this changed guy and see how much this condition has changed. So I take this and dot it with del square, with del mu. So the first term gives me minus del square eta mu. What about the second term? The second term gives me minus del mu del dot eta. Third term gives me plus del mu of del dot eta. So these two terms cancel. Okay, so what we're left with is minus del square of eta. Okay, so now we come to the following conclusion, that the unfixed coordinate invariance in our new gauge is given by harmonic changes of it. Okay? Now, this is measure zero in the space of all coordinate fields. Because an arbitrary coordinate transformation is labeled by a function of four variables. A function that obeys an equation of motion, like this harmonic condition, labeled by a function of, for instance, three variables. Okay? So it's a very small amount of coordinate variance that we've not fixed. But as always happens in both Einstein's theory and Maxwell's theory, this very small amount of unfixed coordinate invariance would be very important. Okay? So we keep this in mind. So we fix coordinates up to harmonic changes of variance. Okay. So now, forgetting about the fact that there's some unfixed coordinate invariance for the moment, we'll just go ahead and write down the problem. So, what we want to do is to write down Einstein's equations. Now, the flat space Einstein's equations are just r mu nu 0. You just want to write down r mu nu 0. But we're interested only in r mu nu to a linear order in h. Now, you remember r has two terms. There are the terms that are second derivative of the metric, and there are the terms that are products of gamma functions. Christoffel's terms. Okay? The second terms are quadratic in h. No, so we only bump the first derivative terms in h. Okay? And the terms that are of first derivative, we derive them at various points of the course. I'm just going to write down. Okay? In those terms, wherever you have second derivative of g, you replace g by h. And everywhere else, g is eta, because you want to keep things to first order. Okay? So just write it down.
Mu
delta del by del x theta by del x nu plus del square h nu theta del by del x of theta del by del x of nu, and then minus del squared of h,
h which is h that we talked about here,
del x mu del x nu.
And I should close this bracket. Okay. Now, the reason that we made this particular gate choice is that that expression for RMU greatly simplifies with this limit. In order to see that, let's look at these last three terms. You see, this term plus half of the, let's take the first term plus half of the third. The first term plus half of the third can be written as L by del x nu of del h theta h mu theta by del x theta minus del by del x mu of h by 2. First term plus half term on this line. Okay? Which is equal to one del by del x mu of del by del x theta of h theta mu minus delta theta mu by 2h. Equal to del by del x nu del by del x theta of psi theta mu from our definition of psi, and therefore is equal to 0 given our definition. Okay, exactly similar manipulation. This term plus the remaining half of the third also vanishes. Mu was
removed. Right? So this expression for RMU nu, we should, in general, involves four terms. But this choice of gauge simplifies to about only one term. Is this clear? And therefore, in the choice of gauge that we've been employing, we conclude that RMU and it will.
Okay, thanks a lot.
So RMU is equal to half L square H mu nu. But del squared is just ordinary Laplacian in flat space. So that's pretty simple, right? In order to solve Einstein's equations at linearized level in this gauge, all we have to do is to solve Laplace's equation. You know, this solve the wave equation in flat space. Each component of H mu obeys the wave equation. Let's continue to analyze this a little more detail. One thing to notice is that the solutions to the equation are both and remaining gauge redundancy are of the same form.
Box equals to 0.
Maybe I'm using wrong term. What I mean is the equations are a wave box equals it. When I said harmonic here, I meant box equals it.
Yeah. When box or when function equals zero, the gauge is the there is nothing left.
No, no, we're not in Euclidean space. Sorry, is that what your question? I didn't answer. Okay. Here, the equation of motion is D'Alembertian on H mu equals zero. Unfixed coordinate transformations are also those with D'Alembertian on eta mu is equal to zero. Okay? So now, the counting, the, is this clear?
When you computed the change in the gauge dimension,
yes.
You got that the change is box of something. That eta.
I got the change in reverse this, exactly. And therefore, there was no change if box of eta was zero.
There was no change.
So coordinate changes that respect our gauge condition are those that obey box of eta equals zero. So once you've got into this gauge condition, you want to know, can you make another coordinate change that does not violate, continues to respect the gauge condition, does not violate the gauge condition? Answer is yes, provided if and only if that coordinate change obeys box on coordinate function equals zero. Okay? Now the counting that Pratyush wanted is already used.
Is R mu equal to 0? R mu is equal to 0 already in that space.
Yes, we're looking at Einstein's equations in the absence of stress tensor. So Einstein's equations were R mu nu minus half or G mu nu is equal to number x t. The set T mu to 0. Okay? So R mu minus half R. But if R, if this is 0, then we take the trace of this equation.
Yes.
We also include R as 0.
Yes.
So Einstein's equations are as well written as R mu nu. This is not saying that R A B C D is equal to 0. So we're not in that space. Do you remember we went through this counting? How many components in R mu nu somebody? 10. Quantified by 2. How many components in R, A, B, C, D? 20. So setting 10 components of R, B, equals 0 does not set the 20 components of R, A, B, C, D. Okay? Excellent. Now, so let's continue. The counting now is already, the counting that Pratyush was talking about is already clear. Why is it clear? You see, naively, if you just do nothing, you just stare at this, you say, wow, we've got 10 wave polarizations. So X mu runs over 10 different indices, 10 different combinations, each of which obeys a wave equation. That's right. So you've got 10 different waves. It's not right. Why is it not right? Well, of course we've got nothing. We got this condition only after we've imposed a gauge condition. This gauge condition kills 4 of those polarizations. So 4 out of 10 is good. However, note that 4 more are killed by this coordinate, by 4 more of pure gauge. Because you see, while the amount of pure gauge, this was a small fraction of the set of total number of functions, it is a finite fraction of the total number of solutions to the equation. Yes. See, when we impose 4 conditions to fix a gauge transformation, we found we didn't completely manage to fix gauge transformations. But you know, the counting can never be totally wrong. You fix 4 conditions to fix 4 functions, you must have done more or less something, right? Unless you weren't really setting 4 conditions. The fact that we did completely fix gauge transformations was reflected in the fact that some coordinate transformations left our gauge condition unchanged. But that coordinate transformation had to satisfy a differential equation. So it was not a function, not a free function of 4 variables, but could instead be thought of, let's say, as a free function of 3 variables. We
if the solution is a differential equation labeled by initial data, which are free functions or three functions. Okay? So you might have thought, you might say that this is a negligibly small fraction of the net coordinate invariance we had. Now, because the net coordinate invariance was four functions of four variables. What we're left with is four functions of three variables. That's infinitesimally small compared to four functions of four variables. So you might think this will not play any important role in dynamics. However, you must be careful. Because equations of motion do exactly what we were talking about. You see, in the space of all metrics, which is metrics are functions of four variables, not all metrics are allowed according to equations of motion. Only distinguished metrics are allowed. Those that are labeled by initial data, those that satisfy the equation of motion. And the equation of motion had precisely the same differential operator as that determined unfixed gauge invariance. So while the coordinate invariance that was unfixed was a negligibly small fraction of all functions of four space-time, it's a very important fraction of those particular functions that are solutions to the equation of motion. In fact, there are four of them. It's clear, and we see this more detail, that we can use these four eta's to get rid of four more PHs. So the correct counting is that there are two gravitational waves. There are two functions in space-time, two remaining functions in space-time that obey the equation box square. Is this clear? Okay, you have a problem in your first problem set asking you to work out things like this in a similar gauge in electromagnetism. We basically worked it out here. Okay, but do that. Okay? Fine. Now we want to make this a little more precise. So, a little more concrete. So just to understand things a little bit. So suppose we look at a particular example of a solution of such a thing. That is, suppose my three space coordinates were x, y, z, not these six space coordinates, and then time. And I define a new set of coordinates, I define x plus. X plus t by square root 2 and x minus is equal to x minus t by square root 2. Now, as you know very well, any function of x plus satisfies this wave equation. Traveling waves. Formally, why is this the case? Formally, this is the case because del squared in these coordinates becomes del 2 squared plus del 3 squared. Those are attached. But plus del minus. Perhaps with a factor. Probably with a factor. Just a let me work out the matrix first. So, ds squared is equal to dx2 squared plus dx3 squared plus 2 del x plus del x minus. Oh, mostly minus convention. Plus 2 And see, this eta is a function of four variables. But it remains a differential equation. And therefore, it's a function of three variables. But there are four such functions.
And the same thing with this place like that.
Yes. Okay. Good. Yeah. So, so because this is 2, so eta plus is 1, 1, so this is 2. Okay. Fine. So this del square operator looks like del 2 squared plus del 3 squared plus 2 del plus del minus. So clearly anything that is a function only of del plus is an ideal, because each of these three operators are an ideal. Okay? Fine. So we take a look at waves that are the special case of waves that are functions of. Okay, let's look at waves. Solutions like h mu nu is equal to h mu nu of x minus. Okay, a wave that's traveling to the left is a function of x minus t. Traveling at the speed of light to the left. And to the right. To the positive x direction. Okay, now, for such waves, let us work out exactly what our gauge condition is. So if this is true, it's also true that psi mu nu, where psi is the thing we define, h minus trace subtraction, is equal to psi mu nu of x minus. And for convenience to do this algebra in terms of psi and h. Okay? So let's first work out what our gauge condition means for this sign. Okay, so our gauge condition was that del mu psi mu alpha of the equal to 0. But the only derivative that's non-zero of this particular wave is the minus del. Okay, so what we're getting is del. Everything is a function of just one variable, so we denote derivative by a dot. So we're getting psi minus alpha dot. That was our gauge condition. Okay? Now, we're interested in waves. Things like e to the pi, k dot, something. So if derivative of that thing is equal to zero, the thing itself is. Because you pull out and the derivative just gives you a k plus. So we're not interested at the moment in the special case k plus. Okay? So, as far as wave motion is concerned, we're setting psi minus alpha. Okay. Now, let's see what this what the unfixed gauge transformation does. Okay? The unfixed gauge transformation, how does it change h? Well, we don't want to spoil the fact, just as a choice, you know, our solution was a function only of x minus. We want to continue to have it only as a function of x minus. Okay? So we're going to look at the unfixed gauge transformation. Zeta mu equals zeta mu of, what did I call zeta mu? Eta. Eta mu is equal to eta mu of x minus. Okay? And then look at those special kinds of Bodman transformations. Clearly, they obey del squared and eta is equal to 0. Okay? So, delta h. So, we're now going to see under such Bodman transformations how h changes. Okay? So, delta h. Minus nu. Is equal to. Delta h minus nu is equal to del minus eta nu plus del nu eta plus the minus sign. And we have two special cases. One case
This is the only components that change. Because the only non-zero derivative is the del minus del. Okay? So basically what this does is move h minus, is to shift h minus over the lower anything by an arbitrary function. There are four such guys: h minus plus, h minus minus, h minus 2, h minus 3, and they can be shifted by arbitrary amounts. Okay? Now, we're going to use. Now, it's important that it shifts h minus to the lower minus. Because a metric in plus and minus is off diagonal, can you see that h minus lower is like h plus with an upper? Okay? So what this coordinate change does is allow us to set h plus nu to anything arbitrary for all four components of nu. Okay? Now, what does that amount to in terms of psi? Psi is an admixture of h and the trace of it. Okay? Now, you see, the parts inside that are moved by this coordinate change are those with a plus on top or the trace parts, because the trace are mixed. So, using all of these comments, I now want to claim the following. You tell me if you believe this. You can use this unfixed Bayesian variable to set h plus 2, sorry, psi plus 2, psi plus 3, psi plus minus. And psi 2 2 minus psi 3 3 to 0. You might ask me, why don't you also try to set psi plus plus 0? And the reason for that is that that was already split. At least in derivative. It was already zero, because if you have minus on top, that's equivalent to having like a plus at the bottom. So anything with a minus on top was already zero. That means anything with a plus at the bottom was already zero. So I don't want to put a plus at the bottom. And that's an automatic thing. Okay? The one that's not automatic is this trace. And this you were allowed to set to zero, even though it has no plus in it, because psi is not h. It has the admixture of the trace functions. Okay, great. I'll ask, if you find this a little confusing, just go and check it. You just check how all these components transform under. We've explicitly written down how H transforms. You can explicitly write down how all these components transform. You find something non-zero. You can use these. We can use that transformation to set these guys to zero. So we adopt the state choice. Now what remains? Of the 10 components of psi, 4 have been set to 0 because of a gauge condition, 4 have been set to 0 because of a new gauge condition, using up the unfixed gauge. Okay? What's not 0? What's not zero is psi 1 Okay, this is the plus. This is the trace point.
psi 2 minus psi 3 traceless part of the dam, and psi 2 psi symmetric, of course. I mean, when both indices are lower than raised, so psi 2 3 and psi 3 2. These are the two components that have not been set. Now, notice that in general, psi and h were different. But in the particular case that h is traceless, or that psi is traceless, psi and h coincide. But our conditions ensure that psi is traceless. You see, the trace part in 2 and 3 is 0. And the other part, the other trace part, which is psi plus minus psi minus plus, matches. Okay? So, we can now replace this by, if we want to, by h. So, it's h2, 2 minus h3, 3, and h2, 3. These are the non-zero components. Okay? So, what have we concluded? We've concluded that a wave moving the x direction has two polarizations. The first polarization, we've also given a convenient label. The first polarization has h in the 2, 3 direction. 2 and 3 is the plane perpendicular to the motion of the wave. H2, 3 step. The second polarization, h2, 2 minus h2, 2, 3 step. Now, these two components of polarization are not as different as you might think, because they're related to each other under rotations. You see, what's going on here is what we've got is, if we effectively take this four-dimensional problem and reduce it to two-dimensional problem, as a little group theory would tell us, must be the case. The little group of four-dimensional massless particle is SO2. Okay? Now what we've got is something that's transforming some representation of SO2. This is the rotations transverse to the direction of the wave. What representation? Well, it's transforming like a traceless symmetric tensor. You see what we are allowing? Now, the most general components of the tensor, that traceless and symmetric. There are two components of that. We parameterize that by the off-diagonal guy and the traceless part of the diagonal guy. But more invariantly, in a more invariant way, these modes are parameterized by the components of a traceless symmetric two-dimensional tensor. Okay? And of course, since a trace is invariant under rotations, and since symmetry properties are invariant under rotations, first, a two-dimensional tensor transforms under rotations. Now, the trace is invariant under rotations, so that's a singlet part, throw it away. Symmetry properties are invariant under rotations, so the symmetric traceless guy transforms in itself as a representation. It gets mixed up by rotations. It's an easy exercise to convince yourself that these two components mix into each other under two-dimensional rotations.
What is the general element of this sort of group argument?
Let's look at it. So let's see, how does the general element of the SO2 group act on the y-x? But actually, it's even easier. Let's write it out as a matrix. Okay? Then as a matrix, what we do is just cos theta sine theta minus sine theta cos theta. And probably the transpose. Probably this thing has a constraint.
because each of the indices is acting on like a vector of this. And because we're acting from the right, we have to transpose.
So this transpose is cos theta minus sine theta sine theta cos theta.
So trace is clear. Trace is clear.
And symmetry is also clear. Because you see, we're acting on each index the same way. That's what it's like. But the fact that this matrix was symmetric. See, what we're doing is we've got matrix M, and we're acting on it by R, M, R transpose. Let's take the transpose of M. So M was equal to M transpose. We want to see if the root of M is also equal to the transpose. Let's take the transpose of this side. We get R transpose, so R M transpose R transpose is equal to itself, because M is equal to M. Okay? So this action preserves both symmetry as well as trace. So just mixes these two elements into each other. In according to the formula. So, if we call this guy equal to alpha, this thing here would be alpha minus alpha. And if we call this guy equal to beta, this would be beta beta. And so then, multiply this out, that gives you the action. Okay? So, this is basically the statement that the gravitational waves are spin two waves. Because they transform the tensor. Each component of the tensor is a vector. Guy spin one. This thing transforms spin two. Is this clear? It's two vectors put together. Is this clear? Okay? And I'm fine. The last thing I wanted to say about plane waves is about how to compute their energy. Now, the energy of this wave can be computed in many ways. One convenient way is just to use this Landau-Riesz pseudo-tensor, the path that we haven't derived, you know, the path that is purely gravitational, and evaluate it. The path that you get by taking T total minus T lambda. Because in this case, T lambda is zero. Oh, right, you can evaluate however you want. So you take the lambda loop shift sooner than so the path is like, just erase the statement about the paths that we have. Just use our definitions for the lambda loop shift sooner tensor. Truncate to quadratic order. So that will be the minimum order at which you find energy. And evaluate the energy. Okay, straightforward exercise. We know what the pseudo tensor is. We've got a clear definition in terms of derivatives of the metric. We know what the metric is doing with the solution. Okay, it's a straightforward exercise to evaluate the pseudo tensor and the solution. Okay, I won't try to do it here. Umesh added to the problem set. And I'll just write down the answer.
Initial data, that's some angle, it's not at I think x plus plus x minus equals 0 is right.
Yeah, but that's no problem.
That's no problem.
Well, meaning, you could work with your initial data in the old quantum system. This new quantum system is just a convenience.
And then we go
back. You can go back. So in the end, our polarization is entirely plus or minus. 2 and 3 are just the same amount. So these statements are true in the old quantum system. You see, plus minus is just a fancy way of saying traveling. Yeah, I just to ease some algebra, I went to this new quantum system. Landau Lipschitz doesn't even. His presentation he always takes to the quantum system. Yeah, if that's confusing you, you can just work it out. Okay, I would to write down the energy. Okay. So Landau Lipschitz report that d mu nu is equal to 1 by 32 pi a times h alpha beta mu h beta alpha nu. When you take the Landau Lipschitz pseudotensor, specialize the terms quadratic, and set matter terms to zero. Specializing some quadratic. Okay, and then evaluating this on this way, gives you what you need. It gives you the energy momentum tensor of this wave. So the formula is very similar to the energy momentum tensor given by the electron. Okay, there will be one contribution from each polarization. And it's nicely summarized in that form. Okay,
if you choose your initial data on a given space, then are you necessary to stick to coordinate system at t equals 0 in that space?
No.
How do you bypass solving it? If you're working in some random coordinate.
Well, I mean, any coordinate, given a differential equation, you can set initial data to an arbitrary slice. Say we've got a differential equation with derivatives in two formal variables, alpha and beta. There's nothing imposed about setting an initial condition on some alpha equals beta squared. Yeah, the theory of differential equations doesn't need you to set the boundary conditions at one of the variables of your equation. I think we're basically, I'm going a little slower than I hoped to this was. Okay, where are we? Of course, we're at the beginning of October, so when does the term end? December. And you guys have some lab or something like that in December?
November.
Oh, it ends in November. So we've got 2 months to go. It's not too bad. We have one more lecture radiation. What we've not talked about, so we've just talked about free gravitational. What we've not talked about is how radiation is created by sources. You know, we want the equivalent of the, what is it, Lamor formula, electromagnetic. Okay, so we want to discuss that. I want to discuss one more thing in Landau Lipschitz that, before we talk about cosmology and black holes, and what the first correction to the Newtonian Lagrangian. You know, if you've got a bunch of gravitating bodies and they're interacting with each other, Newton gives us a great Lagrangian. I think we wrote that down, something like it, many times in classical mechanics courses. Kinetic energy, there's a potential energy between each body and that's kind of. Now, you could ask general relativity completely changes the formalism, includes electromagnetic radiation and so on as well. But you could ask, is there some approximation scheme in which it corrects this Newtonian wave with the gravity? Now, once you start radiating off energy because of radiation, then what formalism breaks down? You have to take the Gauss units, the degrees of freedom in the field. It's not good enough to talk about potential. But as we will see, the radiation in general relativity is so slow that it happens at order v to the power of 5. That is, when I say v, it's like v by c. Okay? The Newtonian Lagrangian involves v squared. So that's v to the 2. So there's a lot of room between 2 and 5. So until you reach 5, where there is there's no sense in which you can correct the Newtonian Lagrangian, you can ask, what is the effective correction due to general relativity of the Newtonian Lagrangian? And this is a very interesting question, because it shows you how within the Newtonian way of thinking, things change. Okay, so that's the second thing I wanted to work out. That's probably one or two more lectures. Okay, after that, we're going to devote the rest of the time to more or less equally spaced to black hole physics and cosmology. And that's when we'll start having real fun, because these are the two real current today, I think.